I'm Hiko, the Master Baiter, and you're watching Thorin's YouTube.
Team Liquid is one of the very best CSGO teams of 2018. You look at their resume, it's fabulous. Four times in the final of big international prestigious tournaments. Top four in something like seven notable tournaments. Obviously, subjective is what's notable. I removed some of the ones like Belo Horizonte that I didn't think were that stacked. Including, by the way, they were top four in a major. But what is it that everyone looks at? What does everyone focus on? The obvious thing, the empty trophy cabinet, the lack of a true prestigious international trophy, which currently haunts this team. But it's not just not winning, bad way to phrase it, it's not just losing in the final that has haunted them, it's the nature of how they've lost, and now some of the context, which makes it suggest a lot of these factors are on Team Liquid, not just the opponent winning the game. Because first of all, I know people want to draw this thread because Team Liquid's famous for choking or not being able to get over the line at 14 or 15 rounds. So people want to tie the theme back to the old Team Liquid teams of the past years, which I don't think entirely works. Like, there's a level it does, like, funnily enough, famously, we've seen similar things happen. I would give an example in League of Legends where like TSM has these problems with how they use their junglers forever, basically, despite the fact the only player who remains from the original TSMs that people consider that to have been a problem in is Bjergsen. Technically, he wasn't even there from before that when it was the odd one in Reginald with similar style of jungling and mid player. And can it really be one player determining the way the whole team works? Doesn't necessarily make that much sense, right? But then all the same, the theme continues. So is there a cultural aspect that when you put other pieces in, you plug different players who actually are different, they become, in that particular sense, like that. And so their mentalities change. I mean, I would contrast this with FaZe Clan. FaZe Clan is a great example to me of how this concept of like a team being clutch or coming through in the big moment is very different to a player. Because if you ask me about a player like Guardian, I'd say he's a fabulous player under pressure, very clutch player, but he hasn't won many championships in FaZe. I mean, he has. He's actually won some like five titles, but he could have won like 11 or 12 or something ridiculous. Look at Olofmeister. This is one of the most clutch players we've ever had for a star player. He's not a star player now, but he's in FaZe Clan. He sometimes does win clutches. Nico, in isolation, ignoring finals, is a fairly clutch player. Very good in 1v1s. So how do they end up losing all this? Obviously, historically, Rain in the old FaZe, old G2, old Kingwood, also famous for clutching. So now you look at the team. Oh, wait a minute, who's their in-game leader? Carrigan, a guy who's always good for a crazy clutch every now and then. So how is the team failing to do it? Because there's something about the culture, there's something about the setup of their communication, something about what they choose to do, their decision-making under pressure, how they respond to pressure, and actually having a different makeup of teammates, even though in isolation or in different teams they might have been clutch, can change the effect of how they then feel, how they behave, how they act. That's why team culture is a very important concept. So let's just consider for a second those past Team Liquids, but I'll show you how they're different. Because in 2016, let's be real, they didn't make that many big runs. They basically had the two majors where they made top four. They had ESL New York. Beyond that, there wasn't a whole lot in terms of deep runs. So realistically, 2016, they were just a nice dark horse team. They were a nice team that could do upsets. Also, they were heavily powered by Simple at those majors. So it feels a bit unfair to include that in them choking because they really had no business being in that position to be in a big semi or a final and then lose or be up in a big game and lose because they had one of the most outrageously talented prodigy level players we've ever seen. He's not even from NA. It's not even like he came up in Team Liquid. And for one of those events, the one that they did the best at, the final of ESL One Clone, he was just a stand-in. So I don't entirely feel like it's fair to put that on the whole choking thing and carry that narrative to now. You also consider how young their players were back then as well. Elige, I think, was like 19. Simple was about 18. You know, they had some players, in terms of Elige, still relatively inexperienced. They hadn't been in those big situations until that year. So you give people somewhat leeway the first time around. It's only once you choked many times and over many years, you start to say, right, there's a pattern here. Then you look at 2017. I don't think 2017 counts that much either because they were just a team on the rise. They had a lot of problems earlier in the year, couldn't really get it together. And even when they got really sick after the player break, it was only for like three events. Come on. I mean, they beat SK in two of them. They lost narrowly to them in the E-League Premier. They got to some finals. Okay, but you know what? I mean, you could debatably say they were a final in a favourite in the Mykonos final. They weren't a favourite in the final against FaZe at ESL New York. They didn't go that much further in E-League. So it was more like a little burst of form. It wasn't like a strong year and always in position, you know. So I don't think that team is as good or compares to this one. Then you look at that 2017, they had way less firepower. It was the blend of having just enough firepower and a good tactical approach that made them impressive back then. They had Stanislaw and JDM, players that in their own rights, in their own positions, were struggling. Stanislaw wasn't even an in-game leader and he still was having bad numbers. JDM was good against certain opponents and in a certain way, but he wasn't dominating the game with his AWP. Twists hadn't developed as much. He was a strong individual player, but he hadn't been in many finals. He hadn't been in many stage setups. That was like really his first year in terms of playing full on in all the big tournaments. You look at 2018, what makes it disturbing is this is a much better team and the circumstances are much more obvious as to what some of the problems are, because this is a team that is repeatedly failing in the finals, most notably, but they also can be fragile elsewhere. Like, it's quite outrageous that a team that can have so many top four finishes, so many big finals finishes, has had some like last place finishes at like ESL Cologne. Obviously, they had that outrageous first round elimination by NRG at Star Series. They've had a few that have been really bizarre. DreamHack Malwo, they weren't able to get out the group stage. So they've also showed some fragility elsewhere, but not that often, to be fair. They either have an amazing run or the odd shit run. They don't tend to have the ones in the middle. That's what's very confusing, because it makes it suggest that, all in all, they're a very good team, actually. They're better than some of the teams, Fnatic, NiP, that have won one-off events, actually. Then you've got to consider, it's one thing if they were losing to Astralis. It might be, on some level, okay to lose to Astralis, because, first of all, stylistically, it's a nightmare matchup for them, so it's unfortunate for them that Astralis is number one, because they are the mini Astralis. They have a lot of the same qualities as Astralis, but Astralis is slightly better than them in many of these areas, only slightly, and as a result, better map pool, better team player, better nade usage, slightly better firepower, better tactical approach, more experience. You know, when you have that many slight edges, they do add up and you can convincingly and consistently beat someone, especially if they have the similar style to you as well. So, okay, that's one thing. But even then, what, you never once get lucky. You never once break through. You never once have a really great game when they have a slightly off game and just get that win and break through one time. That never happens. I mean, on paper, Astralis have many advantages against Na'Vi. Na'Vi's still being able to break through sometimes though, right? Same with FaZe Clan. So it's a bit, that's a bit underwhelming that you're never even getting the one day where they play not as well and you play absolutely your best and win. That's a bit worrying in itself, because it's just something about your psychological edge means you never get that time where you're really at that level. Plus, unfortunately, if you want to be remembered as a truly great team or player, you've still got to get those wins. Like in tennis, okay, one of my favorite players is Scotland's Andy Murray, right? And if you go and look at him in a Grand Slam finals, he's lost many Grand Slam finals, but most of them were just to Federer or Djokovic, two of the best players to ever play. Now, you can definitely make the argument, you know what, put Murray in a different era, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years ago, he'd win many more Grand Slams. Sure, he would, but that doesn't matter, because he's not going to be like a top five player of all time unless he gets the titles no matter what. So for Team Liquid, yeah, unfortunate for you that you ran into the Astralis era, but unfortunately as well, that's no longer all that we're seeing, right? Because this mouse sports loss at ESL New York is the killer for me. That shows me that it isn't just about playing a team who's better than you or playing a team who has stylistic advantages on you or better map pool than you or better experience than you. Team Liquid is a better team than mouse sports. I'm just going to go ahead and say that now. Every metric suggests as much. Even if you put them against other teams aside from each other, you'd expect Team Liquid to beat more of the top teams than mouse sports, to place higher than mouse sports. Overall, you'd expect them to win more titles, even though Mousesports now has clearly won more, especially this year, and if you count both the lineups. But that's the problem. Similarly, you can look elsewhere. Team Liquid can absolutely beat almost every team in the world except Astralis, so they've beaten Na'Vi in a couple of big semifinals, right? Problem with that is, I joked with Zeus before this final of like, you know, it's great that you got Mousesport this time because this really should be the win for you. I understand you had Astralis before. And my joke to him was, why couldn't Na'Vi have done you a favour in those past tournaments, beaten Astralis like they did a couple of times, but then met you in the final and then you play Na'Vi and you beat them? And he was like, yeah, exactly. But actually, to be honest, since it's finals, not just against Astralis that have been the failing point for Team Liquid and where they seemingly get in their own heads, who knows? Maybe Na'Vi actually would win in a final in a way that they wouldn't in a semi. In the same way as if you go back to 2017, I used to often make the point that if Astralis played against SK Gaming earlier than the final, and especially in a quarterfinal scenario, as they famously ended up doing at PGL Krakow, that's when Astralis could beat them. Put Astralis in the semis against Thorin in the final, then it got a bit harder, then the buff seemed to go to SK in terms of like clutch play, Astralis seemed to get a bit in their own heads. I think there's some component of that going on. So right now, it's not even about just Astralis. You put them in a final like as many teams, you'd think, I don't really know if Team Liquid's going to do it. Then you got to consider, what's the one title they did win? Because they did win a title and against top international competition. They won CS Summit 2. They beat Cloud9, who just won the major in amazing fashion. They beat SK Gaming, one of the best lineups of the last year or two. The lineup that won 3 out of 4 lands. So what's the issue? Why did they win that land and not the other? Well, that land's just in a house. That land's not with a massive stage setup. It's not with massive fans. It's not an insanely prestigious event. There's not all the media hype around it. People, oh, who's the favourite and what's going to happen here? this is some really disturbing stuff, that this team's been so unable to get over the hump in this particular sense. Because you look at the team, and unlike those past Team Liquids, where they had some qualities going for them, but they weren't the best, and they weren't supposed to win the titles, and even their best runs were like good days of form and not as frequent as this Team Liquid. Unlike those teams, this team has all the pieces, seemingly, to be a champion. Not to be the best team ever or anything. No, they have flaws in that sense. But to win championships, to sometimes be the best team on a certain day, or to beat the best, yes, they have them. They have great firepower. Great firepower. They have twists, monster aim, streaky firepower. As he grows older, gets more experience, starting to become more of an established superstar. You have Naf. This is someone, by the way, twists aim might be up there with, he might be top five in the world in terms of raw aim. Then you have Naf. Not as sick an aimer, but fabulous fragging power. Very strong individual talent. All-around talent. Is a hybrid player as well, obviously. Can play passive, can play aggressive. Someone who seems to have his game pretty much polished at this point in time. He's a couple of years ahead of a twist in terms of his evolution. Then you've got Elige. So stable. Doesn't even have to be the star player anymore, but sometimes can do that. Generally just is a very, very stable player. Goes with his playing style, his aiming strengths. Then you have Nitro. Super overqualified in terms of fragging for an in-game leader. This guy can entry like a god because he used to be a pretty strong entry player back in 2015. Now, you can debate how good he is as an in-game leader, because whenever teams don't win and they can't come over the finish line, you have to look at the leadership aspect and who's making the decisions. But quite frankly, the team looks very solid tactically most of the time. Looks like he's doing his job. Him and Zeus, however they work together, seem like they're getting a good style implemented that makes use of the players. So I can't even say it's just him as an in-game leader. Like, would I, as a fantasy, like to see them bring in, like, let's go ridiculous, Fallen or fucking Carrigan to be thinking. I'd certainly like to see it. I'd like to see what they do with those raw talents. But I also think Nitro's doing a pretty good job, and obviously sometimes has some ridiculous games for an in-game leader. Then you look at Tackle, the last player. He's not supposed to frag. He doesn't even fucking need to with these players. He's got experience. He's played for many, many years. He's a supportive player that helps the star players that we have, all that talent. He's an established champion. He's been there before. Then you look at their map pool. They've got a fabulous map pool. You go beyond Astralis, and I actually think that you can put Team Liquid right up there with fucking Na'Vi in terms of map pool. These are the best map pools in the world. They're a top three, top four map pool in the entire world. Realistically, there's only two maps they don't play. Overpass and Train, which they swept their permabans between. Well, they were legit on Train earlier in the year, so if they were really forced to, I think they could play it like Astralis could play Cash. And they used to play Overpass last year, so I think if they were forced to play that and put more time in it, they'd get half decent at it. But go beyond those, they can play all the maps, and they're pretty good on the top end of the maps. Absolutely, and the stats suggest as much. Now, maybe they need a more reliable superstar. Twists might become that. I thought Naf was going to be earlier in the year. He was the fabulous one. It used to be Twists that disappeared. So, I mean, maybe you don't even need a reliable superstar if both of them can be very good, right? That could be a fabulous way to get victory right there. They probably do need a little bit better pressure, better calling when under pressure. But even then, it's only happening in the finals. And there's pressure in semis, but it is a different kind of pressure. That's a tough one to nail, isn't it? Maybe Zeus's coaching isn't fully attuned. Like, I think he's doing a very good job. Every time I talk to him, he has a good idea for the game. Maybe the culture difference, though. Maybe there's other buttons to press there. Or maybe he has to go a bit softer with one guy, a bit harder with another guy. I don't know. I will say the mental frame for this team is something I find quite concerning. Because if you pick out, the ones I definitely pick out is like Elige, Naf, and Nitro. These are guys where in interviews, you don't get the sense that they think they're going to win. Like, Elige is the most ridiculous, I think, because he just will never say anything that sounds vaguely confident or cocky. It's always like, let's see, or I don't know, we'll play our best and see what happens. Like, that's a little bit concerning. The Naf one, it's not that he's, like, doing that entirely. He just doesn't seem, in interviews, like he has, like, crazy fire or drive. He'll sometimes say something a little bit hot, but then also, obviously, like, when he played shit, he seemed a bit ambivalent there. I think he just has a weird personality. Nitro, again, is like a Elige in that sense. He's just going to say nice things. He's just a friendly personality. So, unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of fire there. I'll give credit to Taco. Taco's doing this job. He's saying we're going to win. And now that I'm here, I'm the missing piece. And we're going to get over the hump. We're going to defeat these teams. I like that. But I wish there was more of it coming from some of the star end of the players, because they're some of the ones that go missing in the game. And you wonder, do they have it within them? Are they battling themselves? Are they second-guessing themselves? Are they thinking, oh, what's going wrong, and not being able to get out of those situations? Because that's where people in the past who've been chokers have had those issues in those kind of scenarios. Now, one of the problems in only losing in big finals is you can't practice for that scenario. There's no practice scenario you set up that creates the same atmosphere and feeling and internal pressure as being in a big final. That's why FaZe Clan couldn't practice for it. They were so good they could beat literally everyone in the world, but they lost many, many finals because when they got in that situation, they were just in denial of it, or they didn't want to believe it, or they thought it just wouldn't happen this time. There was no real way to prepare for it. So, okay, what is one way you could start to offset it? Sure, you could work with a sports psychologist or sports psychology trainer. That's not guaranteed, though. And also, that might help some players, might not help others, might even make some people think differently about the game and second-guess themselves entirely. So I think it's worth a shot. As far as I know, they already have someone like that anyway. So that's what I mean. It's not a cure-all. I mean, if it was, top sportsmen would do it, and Andy Murray would have won all the fucking Grand Slams. Or would he? Because he's playing some of the better players, right? See, that's the tough thing. When it gets into the realm of the mind, it's very hard to know what's going on. Then you've got to consider, how did Astralis overcome the same problem? They used to have the same problem in semis when you went back to 2014 with Dignitas. Then in TSM, they could win the tournaments. They could beat Fnatic almost every single time. They could beat all these squads, but they could never win the major. So same thing, but on a higher level of pressure. Now, though, they're gods. They're winning almost every tournament. Worst results are like second or top four. They've won a number of majors. How did they do it? Well, the problem is they went through. You know the old saying, I think it's like Robert Frost or something, like, you know, the way out is through. That's like what Astralis did. Their logic was like, well, you know, when we're in really close games and it's like a deciding game, then sometimes we get like put under pressure by some of the best teams and we can break then. How do we fix that? Well, the easiest solution would be never get to deciding maps, beat everyone 2-0, beat most people without them getting double digits, only ever lose the odd one 16-13 or 16-14, but still win the series or win most tournaments. Like, that's not a solution, is it? You have to just become gods to basically, which is what Astralis did. Now, I will say within that, one thing I remember with the Kirby lineup of Astralis, and now that I have noticed does sometimes push Astralis over the edge when they're in trouble, is something I've also seen from the Mouse Sports lineups, which is Glaive and Christier, the in-game leaders, both of whom were also overqualified like Nitro as fraggers for in-game leaders because they've played other roles in their careers. They both will sometimes, in those tough scenarios where it looks like the rest of the team's hesitant, take it upon themselves to do a really ballsy call, which involves them going first, entering, getting a sick, super aggressive push off, which then sort of imbues confidence in the rest of the team. They break open the game and they sometimes get the win from doing that. So in the same way as Glaive and Chris J could, I think Nitro absolutely could do that. He's done it in the rest of his career. He's done it in his certain times with Team Liquid. I think that's something that could be a game changer. Because obviously, I've done this many times. I would contrast them to the Dignitas and TSM lineups. Same thing. They can beat the better teams. They can compete with the better teams. They've got the pieces. You look at those teams that was like Cage and B, Device, Dupree, and then you get to Zipnix and Carrigan or other players. These are fabulous players. That's why it was so hard to cut any of them. They were all really good players and really good at their roles, just like Team Liquid is now. It's not like when they were Team Liquid 2016, and that team shouldn't even, you know, with Adren or later on with the JD, these teams shouldn't be winning the big titles or the majors, should they, realistically? This squad now, by all rights, probably should. They've got the talent to, you feel like they could beat everyone. They even on paper should sometimes, like I say, if you play them enough times, beat Astralis once or twice, surely. So there is some sort of a problem with Team Liquid and the finish lines. But you know what? Also take heart from the Astralis example. They were also very young players. They were also players who just needed a few tweaks. They're also players who had the same weaknesses, but shored them up a bit and kept building on their strengths. And what about now? Well, now they've got the last laugh, haven't they? Now they're gods. Now they've won multiple majors. They're the dominant team. All the teams who used to be beating them, used to cause them nightmares, haunt them. They're shitting on these teams now. Most of those teams aren't even at their level anymore. They've all dropped off. So take heart if you're Team Liquid. You've got that young core. You've got the pieces. Now it's not about doing something drastic. It's about doing the small things. It's about working on things, acknowledging there's a problem, and then eventually getting over the finish line. This video was kindly supported by Gardner Wilson, Dean Tanglis, Alex Adams, Eddie Wingfors, Andreas Snazore Westerlund, Godawful Waste of Space, Kyla Harris, Travis Greb, James Harding, Daniel Yordanov, VeXii, Robert Baxter, and a special thanks goes out to Jerky's Minion. Now, do you want to suggest a topic or a guest for my content? Perhaps you'd like to ask me a question for my monthly AMA. Would you like teasers to see who's coming next on my upcoming content and what's going to be coming down the pipeline? Perhaps you want to take part in an esports discussion with me. Well, put your money where your mouth is and join the Scrilluminati today via the Patreon link below.